This week on Pierce County News, it's a special show on agriculture. Meet an internationally known rhubarb farmer, and eggs go from roost to assembly line. Hi, and welcome to Pierce County News. I'm Heather Radall. We're bringing you a special show from Terry's Berries, a year-round organic farm in the Puyallup Valley. Pierce County has some of the best soil in the world, but it's the people who farm the land today and the generations who came before them that make Pierce County's farming history part of our future. Bob Thronson has the story.
Look at their faces. They're weathered and dirty. They look tired, but they are content. It's the unmistakable mark of a farmer's resiliency and determination. Mount Rainier laid the foundation for the fertile soils of Pierce County. In its shadow, a rich farming history began with the Hudson's Bay Company building Fort Nisqually in 1833. More settlers arrived in the 1850s and started their own farms countywide under the Donation Land Claim Act. In 1882, the hops industry boomed in Puyallup, thriving when the European harvest failed. Hops grew well in the rich valley soil. Farmers like Ezra Meeker made fortunes, which would be all but lost within a decade when an aphid infestation caused the hop blight.
My great-grandfather nearly made a million and lost it all, you know, because the hop market was so volatile. And then kind of transitioned and started growing rhubarb. Rhubarb is probably the one item that's kind of remained, you know, with some long, long history.
In the early 1900s, rhubarb farming began. This is a crate label from 1931, when the Sumner Rhubarb Growers Association opened its new bulb and rhubarb warehouse. That year, they would ship 25 rail cars of field rhubarb and 110 rail cars of hothouse rhubarb. To this day, a quarter of the nation's acres growing rhubarb are right here in Pierce County. In 1910, George Lawler planted the first daffodil bulb farm near Fife. 2,000 bulbs launched the daffodil industry. Because daffodils were grown for their bulbs, not the flowers, the now famous Daffodil Festival and Grand Floral Street Parade began in 1934 to use the flowers that were being discarded. Some people are born into farming, or hard lessons working the land passed down from generation to generation. Fourth and fifth generation father and son, Tim and Timothy Richter, work side by side.
Having him be a part of the farm and seeing him every day, we have our days where we don't really want to see each other, but you know, it's really good that it keeps us close.
Some people love the soil and want to depend on their own hands to make a living.
It's the most honest work that I can find. It's, you know, certainly as real as it comes to be able to take something from seed, produce it, and feed somebody with that.
And others marry into the land.
I wasn't too surprised. It's just that I didn't know what I was getting into.
Berries have been a bumper crop. Look at the height of those raspberry bushes in this 1929 photo.
My grandma Schultz sold berries along the side of the road. Well, now we got like 14,000 cars a day going by, and a lot of people think that's traffic, you know, and we kind of kid around and say that they're customers.
Just as previous generations of farmers learned to adapt and change.
You've got to have a very, very consistent supply. You know, running out doesn't happen anymore. You have to find a way to fill orders.
Today's farmers also face new challenges.
When I plant something, I already know I got a home for it.
Almost done.
In 1940, the average size of a Pierce County farm was 28 acres. By 1959, it had grown to 60 acres. But by 2007, that number had dropped off to just 33.
This day and age, with smaller pieces of land, you really need to diversify if you're going to really be able to survive as a farmer.
Finding a new crop of farmers is vital to the industry's survival. Rallying support from seasoned neighbors and the community makes it easier to weather the difficult days.
Everybody's been great. If I need something, they're there. If I need help, they're there. If I'm looking for knowledge, they're willing to share it.
Because getting a new farm up and running is hard.
We didn't expect to have headlamps on at night harvesting carrots, and there's just a lot when it's just the family.
One of the many challenges to the future of farming in Pierce County is land preservation. protecting in perpetuity the fertile soil that we've farmed for nearly 200 years. When Emma Ford's husband passed away and their 100-acre dairy closed in Orting, she couldn't stand the idea of that land covered in houses.
Well, my husband loved that piece of property, but I've got to believe that this is what was meant to be, and this is the way he would have wanted me to do it, and that's all I can hold on to.
Now, three new farmers work that historic Ford property.
If we don't preserve this farmland, if we don't take action, where are we going to be when we really need to feel comfortable with our food security?
The Pierce County Executive's Agriculture Initiative is proactively helping farmers. We want them to stay here and prosper. The industry also gives a vital boost to the economy, bringing in $100 million in sales annually.
Help encourage and provide the support that our farmers need in order to make farming a viable economic opportunity for the future.
The county actively helps by providing permitting assistance, promoting local products, and educating consumers. We all play a role in the long-term success of local farms.
Well, I would like them to be more aware of where their food comes from and to shop more often at their local farmers markets and at their local farm stores. Our farm stores open year-round.
Talk with farmers about what fuels them, and you feel their passion.
It's the grueling work, and then you get to the market and everybody's happy to accept your produce. You have return customers that come back that are the best. Gotta have those beets. Sanford's beets are the ones we want, and they come back to every single market to buy those.
We'll see you next Friday.
That's what really gives me the fuel to keep pushing forward and trying new things, creating new products.
A passion to work the land, to be the legacy.
We're gonna plant more of this, and we're even gonna have a better year, and I guess it's kind of an addiction in that sense that, you know, next year's going to be even better. You know, it's kind of like gambling, you know, you just kind of get a little fever for it, and planting stuff is that same way.
Look at these faces. They are the future of farming in Pierce County. Because of them, agriculture will continue to prosper.
Growing rhubarb has been a staple on the Richter family farm since the 1930s, but it's the hothouse variety that's helping Tim Richter farm year-round. Megan Hutton takes us to a Puyallup farm in a series we call Meet the Farmer.
Inside this dark hothouse, the temperature is a mild 55 degrees. That's warm compared to the cool February winter of the Puyallup Valley.
We brought these plants in here, you know, in December, and then we've turned on the heat, and then 30 days start picking. And so we've been picking in here since roughly, you know, about the 20th of January. And our schedule is picking every week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday.
100-pound root balls are grown for 2 years out in the field before being brought inside. Over a few months, the plants shoot up stalks looking for light. But with no sun to feed the plant, all the energy goes into the deep red stalk.
The interior of a field-grown rhubarb is kind of on the green side, and then it's a lot stringier. In the house, the stick is, you know, all red, pink, makes beautiful sauce.
So what do you make with hothouse rhubarb? Mostly pies, crisps, and sauces. And as I discovered, you really need to mix it with sugar.
How would you describe that?
Almost like a sour apple.
Yeah, a little bit.
A little bit.
Yeah.
With the texture of celery.
Yeah.
This is considered the pie plant, and for good reason, it makes delicious pies.
Richter also grows summertime crops like lettuce, jalapenos, and cilantro. But with hothouse rhubarb, he can be a year-round farmer, and it brings in revenue so he can retain a core group of 15 workers.
I can keep them busy 40 hours a week, and they're happier, and you know, you gotta keep your labor happy or you're not going to have a very successful farm or business, period.
Hothouse rhubarb is the first local fruit on the market. Workers remove the leaves but keep the crow's feet. Consumers buy with their eyes, and there is high demand for Richter's extra fancy bright red stalks.
We have two grades, extra fancy and fancy, and that's based upon the girth and color, and the extra fancy being the bigger and the more red.
80% of what's picked will be shipped to the East Coast and the San Francisco Bay Area.
It's fun to sell something people want.
Megan Hutton, Pierce County News.
Raising animals on a farm is a pretty common hobby, but for Left Foot Farm, breeding and milking goats quickly turned into a full-time job. Greg McClellan shows us what happens when goats are king of the hill.
Come on!
When the kids hear the dinner bell, they come running.
We use a cow milk with a goat yogurt and some heavy cream.
They're affectionate.
Get some more, baby. That's a more little girl.
And curious, maybe even a little mischievous. 45 kids, as baby goats are called, are keeping farmer Jeremy Faust busy.
So why goats? I think they're cute. They're personal. They're kind of like mini dogs. I do the Nigerian breed, so that makes it, I think they're even cuter and the milk tastes better.
Left Foot Farm in Eatonville is a goat dairy with 85 goats. This dwarf breed has the highest butterfat content at 7 to 8%.
I'm kidding year-round, which I'm producing milk year-round. Typically, I'm milking between 35 and 50 goats. You know, you do it twice a day, and it's mostly 12 hours apart. So you're doing it at 6 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock at night, or something, you know, changing in the summertime a little bit, 8 and 8. But we're trying to go 12 hours apart. And it's about 3 hours, two people, 3 hours each shift.
Even though they milk by machine, staff still have to know how to milk by hand.
But for a dairy steak, it's so much cleaner to machine milk because you're not exposing it, so we just machine milk no matter what.
Cheese, soaps, lotions, it all can be made from goat's milk. 34 Nigerian goats yield about 8 gallons each day. And handling that raw, unpasteurized milk has to be done carefully. There's no middleman between producer and consumer. Jeremy also sells his goats. They're becoming popular with the urban farmer.
And what we're finding in Tacoma and Olympia and Seattle market is folks want to have know where their food came from. So they're trying to, you know, even if they're in a city lot, people are buying, you know, miniature breed dairy goats to get their, you know, get their cup or 2 cups of milk a day for their families.
And if goat milk isn't your thing, it's hard not to love their personalities. Louise wouldn't leave our cameraman alone. She wanted more than the allotted 15 minutes of fame. And this gal put herself in time out.
I have a few favorite goats, but they change daily depending on their behavior.
Greg McClellan, Pierce County News.
Coming up next, meet a young farm family that's just getting their start in the Ording Valley. We're back in just 60 seconds.
This is the moment I knew. His future had no boundaries.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org.
Can you help me with this? My new dad teaches me all kinds of stuff.
Sure.
He helps me with homework.
That would be 3.6795.
Thanks.
Yep.
He helps me with my decision making.
I wouldn't use this one. Ever.
And he's even teaching me how to drive.
And that's why cars have bumpers.
I'm learning so much.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are.
Welcome back to our Pierce County Farming Special. Jeremy Sanford admits he was naive about running his own farm, but he and his family are learning as they go, selling their produce and fresh eggs at farmers markets and co-ops. Megan Hutton introduces us to this budding farmer in the Ording Valley.
So yeah, I am the new kid.
A simple sign marks Sanford's farm, but it might as well say new kid on the block.
The passion that I have and the willingness that I wanted my kids to experience what I was experiencing really was the driving force that said, hey, let's seek out a piece of property.
Jeremy Sanford grew up in agriculture. He managed other farmers' fields. But at 35, he is learning that being your own farmer comes with a learning curve.
That's probably the hardest part of it, is just learning the business aspect and the bookwork behind it and all the research that you got to put into to keep the farm going forward.
We didn't anticipate needing to weed in our sleep, you know.
You can count on the farmer's wife to tell it like it is. This family of five weeds 27 acres of rich Ording farmland by hand. The site is one of three organic farms called the Ording Valley Farms Project, where Pierce County and PCC Farmland Trust have forever preserved this land. Where Jeremy believes his children learn life lessons from picking carrots.
The appreciation for the foods that we are eating and what really goes into it, and that all food doesn't come out of a package.
And laughter in the midst of hard work.
There's just a lot when it's just the family and it's our kids, and they're out there with those headlamps. It's really funny driving by and here's little heads in the field, and oh, his hammers are harvesting carrots again tonight.
Oh, ladies, what's going on?
The family grows a wide array of vegetables and herbs, but just 1 year into farm ownership, the family is discovering niche markets they never expected to be farming, from butchering chickens to selling eggs.
In the first season we were here, we only had 29 birds, so, you know, it was fun, and it was just like recreation. And then this season hit, and throughout the winter, we gained a good 700 chickens.
Come on, moms. Come on, mama. You too.
I wasn't expecting to get slapped in the face by a chicken wing when I'm just trying to get the egg.
But at the end of the day, there's a payoff for living this life.
The hard work that goes in is all appreciated in the end once we get to go to a market and they get to see the reaction of the public.
A reaction that feeds the next generation of farmers.
Like a darker color of what it is, the higher in whatever vitamin it has.
All right, well, I have to try some then.
You can order directly from Sanford's off their website or find them at Tacoma's Broadway and Ording Farmers Markets. They also sell to the Tacoma Co-op and Terra Organics.
Thank you so much, you guys.
Good day.
We'll see you next Friday.
Megan Hutton, Pierce County News.
Eggs are a staple in many families' diets, but how those eggs are created has changed a lot at Wilcox Farms. Dave Hinman shows us how the next generation is influencing this family business.
You could say that Andy Wilcox rules the hen house. After all, these ladies do follow him wherever he goes.
Especially the Rhode Island Reds are so friendly. They're almost like a Labrador dog.
And it can be a dirty job, but does he mind it?
Not really. He just got used to it.
The Wilcox farm in Roy is the fourth largest egg producer in the Northwest. It's been a family business since 1909. Now the third and fourth generations are running the operation.
My brother and I had a requirement for any of the fourth generation to come back and work on the farm or to be a part of the management. They had to graduate from a four-year college and had to work someplace else for 3 years.
It was the fourth generation that forecast a change in what consumers wanted, influencing Wilcox to shift into cage-free and organic egg products.
When the fourth generation came back, they could see that being just getting bigger and bigger and bigger wasn't what they wanted to do.
35% of Wilcox customers buy organic. The Seattle-Portland region is the second in the nation behind the Bay Area in demand for organic products.
We have 500 acres of organic cropland that we're growing small grains that we actually are feeding to our chickens in the feed ration.
With 1.2 million chickens in three states, Wilcox is producing 80,000 dozen eggs a day. Costco is their biggest customer. These eggs were laid today. They'll be washed and inspected, then they're packaged and prepared for delivery. A 500,000 eggs will reach customers tomorrow.
One of the things that we've gone to in the last year are these peeled eggs, because consumers want convenience.
Wilcox has a goal to be 100% cage-free and organic within a decade. And you can bet it will be a family effort.
I work with my dad, and not only my dad, but my cousin and my brother, so it's like a family reunion every day.
Dave Hinman, Pierce County News.
Farming isn't just a summertime business. When Alan Schultz took over the family farm 3 decades ago, his one-acre pumpkin patch in Ording quickly grew into a lifelong business. Megan Hutton reports on the challenges this veteran farmer faces.
When one-third of your business happens in October, pumpkin farmer Alan Schultz has one thing on his mind.
I dumped 4.5 inches of rain out of this gauge there this last weekend. And it rained so hard, I never seen it rain that hard. And then when you don't think it can rain any harder, it started raining again, you know.
Schultz has seen plenty of wet Octobers. 34 years makes him a veteran farmer in the Ording Valley. A beautiful weekend can mean the difference between 1,000 cars a day and 100, where families come to find the perfect pumpkin and have a little fun.
When I plant something, I already know I got a home for it.
Schultz's crop is hyper-local. It travels no further than 22 miles to a Tacoma Boys location. The rest stays here, where the farm store has become their retail outlet. 60% of their sales come from retail.
Well, now we got like 14,000 cars a day going by, and a lot of people think that's, you know, traffic, you know, and we kind of kid around and say that they're customers, you know, because they are. They're going to work or they're coming home, and if they want to stop and get, you know, fresh green beans or fresh corn or all that.
Against the backdrop of a historic barn with Mount Rainier peering over the hills lies the rest of his crop, corn, berries, and rhubarb too. His dad and grandfather worked this land. Schultz says he has learned to never make the same mistake twice. Bad decisions can be life-altering when you live off of 37 acres.
Mistakes are costly, you know, and that's the best way to learn, but in this day and age, with fertilizer costs more than $800 a ton, a bag of corn seed I used to pick up $100 for is $700.
As pumpkin farms become more common, the task of reinventing himself every few years is a new reality. And so far, he's passed that test with flying colors.
Figure out a way that you can relax and get a good night's sleep. You know, that's easier said than done.
Megan Hutton, Pierce County News.
From shearing and shaping to holiday tree shaking, there's one kind of farm that sees its busiest time of year in December. Megan Hutton introduces us to a jolly Christmas tree farmer who works all year preparing for one busy month.
The sound of a frosty morning, the scent of evergreen Christmas trees, and 6'4" Mel Cox. It's all part of the experience at the Cox Christmas Tree Farm in Eatonville.
I taught school for 30 years, and you start wondering, what are you gonna do after that?
Mel grew up on a farm, and after living next to this property, he and his wife, Sybil, saw their opportunity to stay busy. That was 23 years ago.
When we first started, we did a lot of manual work out here. You know, a farm like this is not one that you could make a living at. It's not that big. But since we are retired, it supplements that.
So how does a tree farmer pick the perfect Christmas tree?
My wife takes care of that. I mean, we see the trees all year. We have our tree picked out already. It's out in the field. It's a Fraser. It's about 9 feet tall, and it's the best one in the field.
The Coxes will sell more than 1,500 trees in a season. A 7 to 8 footer will run about $50 to $60. He grows six varieties, but Mel's favorite still looks good on New Year's Day.
And this again is a Nordman, and this is my favorite tree. And as far as needle retention and long lasting, this is a good choice.
January is spent cleaning up the farm, and new trees are planted in March. Shearing comes in July.
We open up then the day after Thanksgiving every year, and that 3 or 4 weeks is pretty hectic. So that's the part that we really enjoy, because before we're out here by ourselves, and now we get to greet people and they come in, and it's a happy time.
Every year they try to add something new, more roads through the farm, a concession stand, and Santa pictures. The basement of the couple's home is transformed into Sybil Cox's wreath shop.
Push, tap, and clip.
For Sybil, the joy of being a Christmas tree farmer is realized when people start arriving.
I think happy customers. People are generally happy when they come and buy a tree. and it's fun to see them go out. It's fun to see the kids.
For all the details on the Cox Farm, visit coxchristmastrees.com.
Here, this one is constructed and decorated and ready to go.
Megan Hutton, Pierce County News.
We hope you've enjoyed this Pierce County Farming special from Terry's Berries in Puyallup. Thanks for watching Pierce County News.